Thank you. direct into the bay and head way over. And of course, now you can follow them all along the list. It's just, it's, you know, it's one of those worlds now. You can just, and she had made 4 or 5 new friends by the time she got to the bay. And then from there on to Lebanon and the ancient city of Tyre, and where God is working powerful ways. So we're going to follow her along her journey again. Amen. Hold her up in prayer.
Amen.
And then know God's going to use her in a wonderful way. And that's a 6-month commitment. So we'll let you know and keep you up to date about how she's doing. Our relationship in Christ is so dear. And David and Sharon are some close friends. We spent the evening together last night. It's great to just, you know, we different worlds and different parts, but just pick up our relationship right here. Talk about the scriptures, talk about our lives in Christ, talk about our families, and have a wonderful time. And I appreciate David. David, you know, is just dear to this church. Now, he's got a huge heart. And he pastored faithfully there in Highland Baptist Church in Dublin. And he's out in the country, but what a powerful church. And he has just poured himself out for missions and the sacrifice to, and blessed us.
Wow.
And our mission. And it's great to have him with us. Just welcome, David. And you know,
took me back there and put me in this, stuck my head in a can
and move in there, and for 30 minutes, there was the awfulest growling and carrying on. I thought there was a couple of raccoons in a hole or something. But anyway, I came out, and I asked the lady, I said, how'd that do? And I just knew she'd say, you were a wonderful patient. She didn't even respond to me. Well, you know, I'm hard to ignore. I'm like a wet dog. I'll shake on you. You know, I'll shake on you one way or another. And as we were walking back there, we walked through this little hallway, out of the truck, into the building, down the hallway, and she said, you stand right here. And I just went back to my childhood days and the teacher telling me to stand by the door. I thought, this is not going to be a good thing. And anyway, she came out in a minute and she had a CD, or a DVD, I don't know the difference. They're both round, they got a little hole in the middle. You know what I'm talking about. Anyway, she came out and she handed me this DVD. And she said, I said, what is that? And she said, that is the results of the test you just did. And I said, and what does it do? It said, it shows your brain. And I said, I've got a brain. She said, yes, you do. And I turned the little deal over and I handed it back to her. And I said, would you write right there, my name is so-and-so, whatever your name is. And yes, David Locke has a brain. And it seemed like a perfectly right question to ask. She's a servant of the people. And she said, I could do that, but there's no evidence that you ever used it. Never wanted to do it before. But what you see in the middle there is a tumor, and it was pressing on my right optic nerve. And I went to this doctor, and let me tell you what I prayed, and I hope I don't sound racist when I say this, but I said, God, don't give me some Arab doctor that can't speak English. Because I've been to them, you know, and if they come in, they'll jabber something, and you're supposed to understand them. And I said, they'll end up giving me a surgery for an ingrown toenail. Who knows what they're going to do? Well, I go in, and I get the appointment, and the doctor's name is Dr. Sadiq. Now, let me tell you something. I pray, Lord, I want to be able to understand this guy. And I thought, God's got a sense of humor. He's putting it on me. And I'm expecting somebody of, you know, the Middle Eastern descent. I walk in, and he's a Colombian. Dr. Sadiq. He's 40 years old. I had 15 minutes with him. And he said, you have the tumor. I didn't know I could play this DVD at home. And he said, it's a little bit bigger than a golf ball. That just shows you how much room I had in there. And he interviewed me, and he talked about, when did you lose, do you have your sense of taste? And I said, no, sir, I don't. And he said, when did that stop? And I said, about 10 years ago. And he said, well, that's probably when this started growing. And so I said, you mean I've had this thing in my body for 10 years in my skull? And he said, yeah, that's right. And I said, what are we going to do about it? He said, well, I'm going to cut you from right here to right here. Let's have the next slide. You have to prepare for surgery. But they're going to cut me from one side to the other. And he said, I'll lay your skin forward, I'll remove your skull, and I'll take this tumor out. And I thought for a minute, and he said, and it's going to happen next Thursday. I said, wait, talk about this a little bit more. But I am right in the middle of a job, and I really would like to put this off at least a month. I've got about 4 or 5 days, and it'll take me a little while to kind of get ready for all this. And I told the men this when I made this presentation at the conference. But he said, "You'll be the doctor, or you'll meet me the doctor?" And I said, "This probably wouldn't be good if I self-diagnosed or if I did the surgery myself." So I said, "Well, you go ahead." He said, "We'll be here and be ready Wednesday." And it's a long story. And anyway, they did the surgery. And I went in for the surgery, and this is, I'm not afraid, and I can't figure why. At first I thought, I have put myself at risk so many ways historically. Playing football when I was a junior, I got hit right smack right there in the face. That's what you can tell. I played football before face mask. Don't be kind. Go ahead. Right. I got hit right there, and my face swelled up, and I didn't know anything. I was goofy. Well, let me rephrase that. I was goofier than normal. For a while, I had amnesia for 4 days. I woke up in the hospital, and the coach was standing there, and he said, "They told me that you was going to be pushing up daisies." I never heard that term before in my life. And so I asked Daddy, I said, "What does that mean?" He said, "You nearly died." The first thing I thought, I wonder if I cussed when I was out. Because I could do it. Anyway, let's start down there. I've raced motorcycles, motocross. I've flown on an airplane. You think, what other? Oh, I rode bulls for a while. So I put myself at risk. But when I finally came to myself, and that took me about 30 years, I finally realized that somebody's in control of me, and they want something out of me that I don't have any idea. I was saved when I was 19, by the way, and I did stupid things after I was saved. I thought that's supposed to fix everything. But it don't fix stupid. Anyway, I came to this diagnosis that I had a brain tumor and they were going to do surgery. And I asked the doctor, I said, "How long will I be in the hospital?" "Oh, just a little while." He was so calm and careful about it. He's a neurosurgeon. Neuro means your noggin. He works on your noggin. And that's what I looked like before the surgery. Now the next slide. That's what I looked like after the surgery. My daughter, one of my older daughters, is a photographer. And she cataloged it. I've got some other pictures that are handy. So I kind of dressed it up for y'all because I figured y'all city folks and y'all haven't got a stomach for what we country people have. But anyway, we had this picture and I was sleeping well. I had 7 hours of surgery and I was kind of out of it there and I was praying all the time. You believe that, don't you? I really wasn't, because I was in La La Land. And during that period of time, and I told this to also the people, I was thinking to myself, not awake, half gone, no eyes open. My eyes didn't open for 4 days. But I thought to myself, am I dreaming? Did I have my surgery already? I wonder what's going on here. And I started feeling, I got this stand in my arm, and I felt that, and I'm dumb enough not even realize that's something from the surgery. But I reached over, and I had this thing on this finger right here. To be sure you got oxygen in your blood. And I hadn't figured out what that finger got anything to do with except something holy. Anyway, I did. He may dismiss me for all this trouble. I just reached up there and grabbed that thing and pulled it off, and when I did, every alarm in the hospital. And this nurse came in, and she said,
"Mr. Locke, what have you done?"
I didn't answer because I thought the best thing, silence is golden. I don't think I could have said anything. Anyway, they stuck that on there, and they put a sock on my head. It was a big sock. I put this sock on my head and tied it up there, and I was really pretty. I have a picture of that, but I'm not going to show it to you because you'd make fun of me. The next slide, there I am again. You see that one place right up here on the top? That thing like to never heal. What they did was he took that scalpel and cut all the way across, and then he took what's called a rig axe and popped me right on the head to break my skull. I'm lying now, by the way. If you tell people you're lying, it's really not a lie. Anyway, evidently that's where they started right there. I had 44 staples that went across. And I got to tell you this, they got all kinds of stuff about short people. And I went by, these staples didn't come out on their own, of course. I go back, and there's this nurse. Something about short people and nursing. She's this tall, and she said, "I'm going to take the staples out." And I said, "Bless your heart." 44, and she'd take them out and drop them in that stainless steel pan. You know, McLean. I carried all 44 of them. I sure wasn't proud. I didn't save them. I thought I'd bring them today, but I didn't stop and think you'd be interested. But anyway, okay, what do you do when you had brain surgery? You just submit to everything and everybody. I really did. I prayed, "Lord, I want to be the best patient they ever had." I did that until they moved me to not recovery. That was 4 days later when I finally woke up, and I was just in the hospital another day, and they sent me to a rehab hospital to get you to do the dumbest thing. We're talking D-U-M-B, dumb. Does that really spell dumb? It does. When I'm dyslexic, that's another problem I've got. It has nothing to do with the surgery. I'm just stupid. Anyway, they want you to unload and load a dishwasher. This is rehab now. I told that girl, and there was a bunch of pretty ones. There was a whole cubby of them and one nurse ratchet in the whole thing. Well, I don't know where I'm going with this. Next picture. Before I left the hospital, they won't be brushing my teeth. Now, why in the heck would you want to brush your teeth if you had brain surgery? I'm not kissing my wife, she's not interested. Anyway, I brushed my teeth. Thought I'd share that with you. That's really interesting, isn't it? Somebody with brain surgery is brushing their teeth. Okay. This is rehab. Two of my grandkids. I went in that room right off to that side to comb my hair for the first time. I looked at myself in the mirror, and I started weeping uncontrollably. So what if my babies are scared of me? So I messed up. But my eyes were swollen almost too. Both eyes were black. And God sent my grandbabies. With a mother that loved me and prepared them for the reality. And two charming children came, God sent them, and I got better. To the point that I left that hospital in 3 days instead of 2 weeks. It wasn't because everything was so good, because I never went to sleep. I take it back. I slept about 10 minutes a night because they'd come in there and check me and be sure I was all right. You know, they do that. I said, "Is that all I got?" Let's see if there's a blank. Oh, there we are. There's one more. That's okay. I see you're rushing me. Go ahead. We know who's in control of this earth. Okay. But, you know, I'm not walking arm in arm with my wife so that, to show any affection. We do that anyway, but we show affection, and I like affection. But we're doing that because after that surgery, I could walk straight for about 10 steps and then no telling what's going to happen. I'd hook off to the left or hook off to the right. And so she was my Geiger count. No, it's the gyroscope, my Geiger count. Okay, now my next one. I'm leaving Mexican food. When I got out of rehab, I went straight to a Mexican food place and we had Mexican food. And that's all that story. Turn the light back on. I said all that to say this. My subject matter is to be trusting God in every situation. Now, that's a mouthful. And it has something to do with this, but it really is not just about me. I'm not going to be the hero in my illustration. I was assigned this subject, and I looked at it, and I decided that's a mouthful. And I'm just going to take a bite today. He gave me a text, Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Now he's the Holy Spirit, the pastor I'm talking about, to give me something to preach about. Now, this would be a series. He gave me Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. And if you'll stand, I'd like to read it to you. And in reverence to the Word of God, you can do that. It says, trust in the Lord. This is a side effect. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. And lead not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him. And he shall direct thy path. Boy, that's good. That's good when you've lived it. I used to think about that and I thought, man, that don't even make any sense until you walk down that way a while. God's got you. He's right there. He's with you. He helps you. And he sustains you. Not without pain. Not without difficulty. But God is good. You may be seated. There are three books in the Bible right in this particular area. These aren't my words because I don't alliterate because I'm not literate most of the time, but there are three words that talk about the three books. The first book is the book about romance, and we had a little bit of that in our Sunday school class, and I could have done something with some of the stuff there that he passed over. You know, the book of Song of Solomon, good one. It's a dandy if you're a man. You can understand all the words. Talks about the navel. Talks about some other stuff that evidently we can't mention in church. But it's a book about romance. It's a book about a love story. And there is an undertow there. And I had a class of young married couples that I taught through this particular book, and I talked about life. I didn't talk about the undertow, but I talked about how it talks about life and how that a man yearns for a woman, and a woman yearns for a man. And when they're separated, they come together and they make a connection and they go apart, and there is that love that they have for each other that is very fleshly, but at the same time is very heavenly. I believe God sends people to love in that special way. A book about romance. And then there's a book about rules. The book of Proverbs. Hardest book in the world for me to preach out of. I don't like to just take a subject and preach on it. I like to take a verse and verses and dig it out and spit it out. Book about rules. And then there's the book about regrets. Written by, penned by the same person. He's an old man. Made all the mistakes. Had 1,000 wives. That's not a mistake. I don't know what is. not because of the wife, but because of the mothers-in-law.
Amen.
Who said that? There's somebody back in this area that's going to have a hard time. But seriously, Solomon still had enough sense by this time that, I've just messed up. He had one of the greatest gifts that a man could have, and that is boundless wisdom. And he messed up. What was the problem with him? He was a man. He was a human. One of the great things about God, when he created us, he told us what we could do and what we couldn't do. And when we didn't do what he told us not to do, that he did do, that not to do, when we messed up, he still loved us. Boy, I tell you, I'm glad God did love us. Love us beyond ourselves. When we disgust ourselves, he still loves us. And the great picture here is a picture of a man who finally comes to himself. God was given everything. I was given money and sex and authority and ability and everything. And yet I constantly messed up over and over. Habitual sinner he was. Now some people say when you get saved you don't sin anymore. That's what I say. I don't say that flippantly. But he said this at the end of his life. What profit hath a man of all his labor which he hath taken under the sun? Solomon. Golly. Built the temple. Great day. I'd love to have been there on that day when they celebrated that. But he still was a man. Normal, ordinary man. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Every situation. That's out there. What I want to do today, if I could, and I recognize my limits in not in imagination. I can imagine a lot of things, but articulating what I'd like to see happen today. I hope we can be here for a coronation today. Coronation of my king. I want everybody here to have God's gift of salvation. But then to crown him as king. I may be wrong about this, and if I am, well, I don't think I'm wrong about this. I believe these are two very separate things that happens in a person's life. But first of all, they get saved. And when they get saved, they're a child, and they don't understand what's just happened to them. But as life goes along, they begin to understand there's more to my salvation than just forgiveness for my sins. That he's got something else for him, for me. I must come to a place that I make him king of my life. Put him number one in my life. And I know I've heard the words and I appreciate the invitation. Make him your Savior and Lord. And for me, those were separate days. But I put my faith and trust in Christ as my Savior. And he gave me the gift of eternal life and forgiveness for sins. But down the way, I came to an understanding that he wanted more from me, and he called me. He called me. Last in my class, little short run, all kinds of things working against me. He said, "Hey, buddy, I want you to preach." But God, you don't understand. Yeah, he understood. He understood exactly. You see, what I was having a problem with is trusting him in everything. 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 Even that? Yeah. Even that. Everything. Every situation. A lot of trust God when we're in the middle of a wreck. I was talking to a man the other day. I was talking about running off a cliff in Mexico. And he said, God, save my family. And he gave a testimony of all of them coming out well. It's one thing. But what about you get up and go to work in the morning? You trust God for that? You trust God that you'll be able to make it through the day at your job? You trust God that you're driving with these crazy people in Dallas, Texas? Y'all are nuts. You get in a car and you just go slap crazy. Hey, don't laugh. It's not funny. But, you know, we don't ever think about the common of trusting God. We think about the extraordinary. A lot of things we know what we can do. I know I can do that, God. And God, you just stand over there and watch me. Why don't you bring him along for every situation? Why don't you praise him for the good stuff instead of praying for the bad stuff in your life? Praise him for what he has done. And we'll get to this text in a minute. Hope you're not in a hurry. Hope everything's not burnt up by the time I get through. But let's just stop and collect myself. And I want to begin with this thing about trusting the Lord. Let me tell you about that word. In your King James Bible, every letter is capitalized. Well, those people that put that Bible together, translated it from all the manuscripts that they had, they came to a conclusion and said, we need to magnify the Lord. We're not talking about a Lord, we're talking about the Lord. We're not talking about your boss or your teacher or your wife or your husband or your mother or your dad. We're talking about somebody different. Somebody unique. Somebody who... Let me just spend a minute now to introduce you to this self-existent one. That's what the word Lord, what the name Lord means. Self-existent. He don't need you. He don't need me. He don't need the Pope. He don't need the convention. He don't even need the church. He's trying to pull all to himself, but he is self-existent. He doesn't run out. He doesn't run over. He's Lord. Now, being the Lord, he is Lord whether you make him king or not. Amen. He is the King of kings and Lord of lords. I know that's said of Jesus, but you know, when you talk about Jesus, Jesus said, "When you want to know what God looks like, look at me." I'm not talking about me. That's what Jesus said. You look at me. You want to look at the real David, because he's the dandy. But his position does not rest on your vote or participation in his will for your life. He's going to be Lord whether you obey him, whether you receive his gift of salvation, whether you follow him, whatever you do, God is God, and that's not going to change. You don't even have to make him king to go to heaven. You can lumber along as a little babe in Christ, never learn anything about the Bible, never attend his church. And we all want those marks of our salvation. Let's put a tattoo on our forehead or let's put a chip in on our wrist or on the back of our hand so people will know we're a child of God. And so we can go to heaven. Let me tell you. If that's what it takes, we're all in trouble because we ain't got enough going for us. Amen. You don't have enough going for you. I don't have that much going for me. I don't have nearly enough to go to heaven. What I have to have is the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let me read this for you. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. You know who the ungodly is? Is that the proper... That is or are. Anyway, you know who that is? It's what we used to be before we were saved. He died for us when we were ungodly. Well, I wasn't all that bad. I was a preacher's kid, literally I was. And I was a lot better preacher's kid than my kids were preacher's kids. I remember it well. Oh, my mother and daddy gone, bless their hearts, and they can't tell any stories on me. I have to make up my own now. He goes on to say, but God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. It doesn't say in this passage that, listen, as long as you make him the authority in your life, that you can go to heaven. But it simply says, and the first message I ever preached more than 50 years ago was from Ephesians 2, verses 8 and 9. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. I tell you, when you take that verse, and as a sibling brain young man, I was 21 years old going on 13 when I preached that message, and yet it is the most powerful and lovely thought that has ever been presented to humankind, that listen, it's not about what you do, it's about what he has done. That he gave his son as a gift, a ransom for our sins. It's a big deal. Not of works, lest any man should boast. You see, you don't have to do anything. There's no physical act, no baptistry, no baptistry, no prayer that you can pray. No. You may pray believing, but that's a whole different dynamic. And I want you to understand that it is important that this king, this one that is the King of glory, the King of everybody, man, woman, boy, and girl, has authority over you, has authority over the smartest people, the most politically powerful people, the greatest infidel. He is the King of them. He is the King of you. He is the King of me. He is over us. He has given us something that we can have that to be a part of his kingdom, part of his work. You see, he's given us the gift of salvation and redemption and forgiveness of the new birth. And then he says, listen, I want you to come along. I've got a job for you. I want you to be one of my ambassadors. Now, this loses a little bit in definition because of the use of the word. I don't know anything about what an ambassador really does. And I don't know whether they're even necessary. I like a telephone. If you got a question for me, call me. I think that we might be better served to talking to people over the phone than talking to them in person and costing millions of dollars a year, sending them all over the world. I'm talking about our governmental ambassadors. Let me tell you what God does. He funds all of our work. You say, you mean he pays me to be an ambassador? No, not anymore. You know, when I was pastoring, our church sort of paid me for a long time, and then they started paying me well and after I had a fit. And it's terrible that you got to do that sometimes, but, you know, I did, and we lost a couple of members about that. They said, that, you know, I didn't deserve any more than I had, and I said, I never will work what I deserve. I got to have more than that to feed my family. But God takes care of it. Now I work to be an ambassador. God put me in a mission field of people that don't even speak my language. And boy, you talk about hard. I was telling Brother Ron yesterday, you talk about a hard thing. You ought to witness somebody that are ESL, English second language. You got some people that translate. You ought to tell somebody about Jesus and all they've heard all their life is the Pope. You ought to tell them about the fact that God tells us. I had a guy say, tell me about you. I'd work with him. Like Ricky at the ranch. That's the way I had him on the phone. Ricky at the ranch. He said, tell me about you. I said, what are you talking about? Your church. And I thought, boy, you have asked the wrong person the wrong question. 20 minutes later, he is standing there looking me straight in the eye with his eyes this big around. He had never heard anything like it, that Jesus paid it all.
Hallelujah.
All to him I owe. Sand had left a crimson stain, but he washed me white as snow. He never heard that. And I thought, when I walked away that day, Lord, I know he didn't understand everything, but would you step in and make intercession with him that he might understand? He knew the wrong words in English. He didn't understand that. Let me tell you this. God's got a way of representing himself with plain old ordinary foolish people like me and like you to represent the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, to prepare a people not only for the church, but also for his kingdom. Things that you do outside this place. If this is all you got, by the way, you're missing the point of your salvation. I got to move home. Just got 15 minutes and I got 2 hours of notes. Let me tell you this. Either side of salvation, either before or after salvation, you may have a problem with the King. Here is my simplest synopsis of the problem that you may have. First of all, he knows you. He doesn't know about you, he knows you.
Amen.
There is a difference. He knows everything about you. He knows everything, and that's a broad view. He knows everything about everybody, but he knows everything about you. There's just not any way. Yeah, there is. He's omniscient. That's a big old theological word. It means he knows everything. He's a know-it-all. He really is a know-it-all. Some of us, you know, I've always said that I've got an opinion about everything, whether I know anything about it or not. But God has an opinion about everything, and he knows everything. You're along with it. And boy, that's a good combination. You see, I want you to understand that he knows the thoughts and intents of your heart. I've read faces before, and many times in the pulpit I'll be preaching, and I mean I'll be laying it down and picking it up. I'll have my socks wet, sweating down the legs, and people. I always said, if you can sleep through a thunderstorm, you can sleep through my messages. And it happens sometimes. And I'll talk to people about the Lord, and you can tell it's just. Went right over their head. And I'm as simple as anybody. But a lot of times I can look at people and I can talk to people and I think something is grinding away. But many, many times I miss the point. But God never misses the point. And in our vernacular, he's got your number. God's got your number. You're on his list. You're on the hit list. You're on the sin list sometimes. You call it and say, do you know that when you commit adultery, the Bible says that God is there. That you're drawing him into the participation of that act. The Bible says that. I can't tell you where it is right now. Did you know when you lie, when that comes off the end of your tongue, because you're his ambassador, you're a child of God, that in fact that is God saying. Because that's all people have is what you tell them. You're getting him to participate in your sin. You say, well, God can't sin. I didn't say that. But it was real close. Because you see, it complicates things because he knows you. He knows the good and he knows the bad. When you do something stupid, and it was for the right reason, God knows it. He's had to clean a lot of stuff up that I've done. Because I did it out of a right heart. But it didn't just come out that way. And I can give you a list. Number two, not only does he know you, but he's also sovereign. Not a word that we commonly use, because there is nothing sovereign in the world today.
Amen.
We don't know much about this position in our modern world, but Jesus, who is God, said it like this. All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. He's God. He's got all power. He can do what he wants to do. He has limited himself, but it's not because of us. He knows us, and he's sovereign. He's able to step into a situation and make a difference. With all the power, however, that he has, he is never an abuser of that power. He's a user of that power and not an abuser. And that is significant because that there's always the prospect of stepping over the line when you have too much power. As our, well, I better not get political, as our modern president has done. He stepped over the line, abusing the power. My judgment, and I'm always right. The Bible says about Jesus, he went about doing good because he couldn't do nothing bad. He did everything but he healed good. He helped good. He went down the way good. He walked with the people who didn't even know who he was on the Emmaus Road because what he was doing was good, both before, during, and after his death, burial, and resurrection. He just does good. He does well. Number three, he doesn't ignore you or play with you. It's not about a game to God. Right. He doesn't take us along like we're some kind of a marionette, little puppet that goes along and shakes around and moves it and says, so, wait a minute, isn't that cute? He don't do cute. If you look at verses 11 and 12, he said, my son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, neither be weary of his correction. For whom the Lord loveth, he correcteth, even as the father the son in whom he delighteth. So you think he can lay the lash to you? You bet he can. He can reach and grab you and hug you and hold you and comfort you better than mama can do it. I hope you understand that this is the way David said it. My rod and thy staff, they comfort me. You ever been comforted with a whipping? The word implies to be sorry. That is, when you get a whipping in a proper way, it ought to bring you to some spirit of repentance. That is, turning around, getting going the correct direction. So, but God doesn't play or ignore us. Number four. You can trust God's action when you decide to step out of the way. You can be sure that God will let you drift away, but if you're his child, he's coming after you. He may catch you by the nape of the neck and draw you back. He may take a child. He may take a wife. He may take a friend. He may take your health. He may take because you see you're his. And he never violates that authority or that place. But you can be sure his sovereignty is not to be contested. You kick against him and you're going to pay the price. I read this the other day, written by a man named Preston Moore, never heard of him before. Talking about God, he will never let you go, never let you down, never let you off. It's a fearful thing to fall at the hands of a living God. So, that's the first point. He is Lord. Number two, he is trustworthy. And we'll pick up our base. In verse 3, it says, let not mercy or untruth forsake thee. Bind them about thy neck. Write them upon the table of thine heart. Now, this is poetic, but it is also very powerful when he talks about this thing about mercy and truth. What is it that he wants us to bind about it? He wants his word to be with us. We want to know what he says, what he thinks, what he says is the right thing to do and what we are not to do. The whole Bible is a chronicle of the trustworthiness of God. It is a fact. This book records God's mercy and truth that is never forsaken. The command, not the suggestion, is, he talks about, he says, let mercy Let mercy, and I'm too worried. Slow down, David. Sit in the corner a minute. Here I come. He says, bind mercy and truth about thy neck. And if you look up that word, that's one word. He said, put it on the necklace. Put it right there for everybody to see. That I'm obeying the mercy and truth of God. I'm doing what the Bible says. It's showing up on the outside. You know, talk is cheap. But doing is something else. Sometimes we're gifted with gab. My wife said, I haven't shut up since I had my surgery. And I used to talk a lot, now I talk more. But it's a medal of honor that we have mercy, the mercy and truth of God. But also it says, write it upon your heart. It's hard to neglect something that's on the inside. That you read the Word of God, you know about God, and you know about His trustworthiness, and you plant it in there, and everywhere you look, and every thought that you have, turn to God, trust my Word, trust me. Trust what God breathed. It came out of God. That's where we got His book. The Bible puts a time frame on God's trustworthiness. He's been trustworthy. Ask the patriarch. Ask Abraham. He's 100 years old. He has a son that was promised. Ask Joseph. He knew he was the chosen of the 12 sons. But he had to go through persecution and trouble and trial from his own family and from the Pharaoh and all those around him. But he came out the other end. Is God faithful? You look at David. Made all the mistakes he had. Committed adultery and killed her husband and all the other stuff. But he came out the other end and wrote the great Psalms. Let me tell you something else. He will be trustworthy. You read the book of Revelations. God's going to reveal His power in a way that we've never seen before.
Amen.
We saw His love demonstrated upon the cross of Calvary. We saw His power in bringing Christ from the grave. But when He comes again, it's going to rock the world.
Amen.
We need to be ready. We need to make Him king today so we don't have to back up and say, look, I wish I'd done this a long time ago. I don't get it. But number three, God, He's the Lord, our King. He is God the King who is trustworthy, but He's involved. He said, in this passage it says, He shall direct thy paths. Remember that this promise is predicated upon you deliberately deciding to trust the Lord with all thine heart.
Right.
I think we have a lot of token trusting. When it's a kind of a convenient thing. When we've got enough money in the paycheck to pay the bills. God, you just stand over there and I got this going my way. Then all of a sudden you have a flat tire and your transmission goes out. It doesn't work always that way. We have to trust Him in everything.
Yeah.
Everything. Let me give you the product of that promise. He says, first of all, I'm going to direct. That means to be right, pleasant, prosperous. Now, I'm not a prosperity preacher in the same definition of some that preach prosperity. But I tell you, everything that God does for you, with you, and to you, is good for you.
Yeah.
It's always good for you. Yeah. It's always good for you. Oh, even that? Yeah! And you know, when they talk about this picture of me right before and right after surgery, that was good for me. And I knew it was good for me, but you see, somebody asked me before, they asked me, weren't you afraid? What'd they have to lose? Heaven! If I'd have died on the table, I could have awakened in glory. You see, and I'm not a big shot. I hope I don't come across that way. But it's a pleasant thing to know that the worst thing that could happen to you is that God would leave you. And He said, I'll never leave you. And I trust Him. But I like this other part of the word paths. I have a hard time getting the S out. That's a well-traveled road. And in the definition, if you look at your lexicon, there's a word that goes along with it, and it says the caravan. I want you to know that you're not the first one to come along to either experience the highs with God or the lows with God. There's been somebody that way before. Years ago, I saw a satellite picture of the Arabian Desert, and there's literally nothing out there but sand. But the picture showed the trails, the paths that the camels made in the desert. They were, even with sandstorms, even with all the movement of the soil there, the sand, there were still places that were, had been there 2,000 years because they were traveled before. Let me tell you this, that God is not only good to you, He's been good to everybody. Everybody that's come before, and He'll be good down the way. You go down a little farther, and there's another filling station that God has for you. You go a little farther, and there's a mechanic for you to help you along the way. And you go a little farther, and there's a counselor to tell you, this is good for you, and that is good for you. Listen to them when God sends them. The path is well traveled. You see, they're so great, a cloud of witnesses. Now, whether invited or not, the king is involved. He's involved in every event in your life. And sometimes he'll scare you to death. Sometimes you'll walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I've done that at least twice that I know of, and probably hundreds of times that I didn't know I was going through that valley. That he pulled me through and pulled me out of. When God is involved, our perspective should change. When we let God be the king of our life, the final authority over us, and the Word being the directive text that we have, when we come to that place in our life, when we look at things, we have to look at them as though God is working. He knows how to fix the problem. But He also knows how to go beyond that. He's able to walk with us and hold us and help us. I'm a person who needs encouragement. Am I different than everybody else? You know, I like for my wife to say, honey, you look good in that suit. Really, she's saying, suit looks good. Because I look the same way I always am. Borderline of. But that's perfectly all right. I hear well. God knew I had, what I needed. But I take all of this. God expects our trust in Him to grow. And the only way it's going to do that is He has to put you in the valley.
Amen.
Or He puts you in the fire. Or He allows you some pain, but nothing more than you can bear because He's there. After my surgery, I went back to the eye doctor that had first prescribed what it was, and first diagnosed my problem. Checked my eye was still a little bit off. It's come back now. But anyway, he said, let's just wait a month before we do anything. I can fix that. I can pull it back around, take a little minor surgery, and get everything lined up. But he said, let's just wait. I told him, I said, boy, you're a rock star. Mine is for me. Couldn't have progressed any farther. I could have lost vision in my eyes. The doctor said I could have been crippled for life. And he said this, first time I ever heard a doctor say this. He said, when I came in, I found out who you were. And you told me who you were. I don't mind telling people I'm a preacher. I'm not ashamed of it. I'm thankful for it. I told him I was a preacher. He said, I knew the great physician was in control.
Amen.
He's not the great coroner. He is the great physician. Mm-hmm. And I got to finish. He is not only involved in every event, He's involved in every transition in your life. I've gone through several. Have you? Life doesn't stay the same. You don't always have a perfect physique. I didn't know what a physique was until way late in life. You don't always have the same mindset. You don't have the same mental capacity. If, by the way, it does dwindle. By the way, it does dwindle. By the way, you forget what you said. I forget where I put the flashlight. God teaches us to adjust, but He's involved also in every season of life. And we got lots of them. Paul said, I've learned in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. Let me close with this. I have a question. I want you to answer them. I want you to answer them out loud. Can you do that? Would you help me? Okay. Is God good?
Amen.
You're observing the living testimony of the goodness of God. My, how good He's been to me. Gave me a wonderful wife, wonderful family. Got 7 kids, 12 grandchildren. Right now we just got 4 great-grandchildren, but I keep telling, keep them coming. I believe in productivity. God is good. We got here this morning. God is good. Everybody take a deep breath. God is good. Does God know you?
Yes.
Just a little bit slower there, aren't we? Does God know you? I heard a message one time by Vance Havner. Does God know your name? And it was wonderful. Number 3. So far, I'd say 90% of you got it. Some of you can say, Sam, I sure am hungry. The 3rd question. Is God all powerful?
Yes.
That's good. Isn't it good to know a God that knows what's good for you and is able to do it? I heard a guy use an illustration of a man standing at a house, looking at a burning house, and his child is up there in the room needing to be saved. And he asked the question, what good is it for a man to be good and not all-powerful? God is not only standing there watching the world collapse around us, but He's able to reach in and rescue us. God is all powerful. Number 4, does God love me?
Yes.
Why would He do that? Why would God love me? Why would God love you? Well, I got so much going for me. And you start tallying up the sheet on one side, debit and credit. Back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. What I make, what I do, what he does. What I do is not even measurable in comparison to what He does.
Amen.
God loves me. But here's a question. My kids, I'll tell you this in a minute. The question is God in a hurry? A lot of people really... You know, I want patience, and I want it right now. you know, that God, I'm here, and I'm right in the middle of the storm, and I need you, and I need you now. God knows. God is able, but He's not in a hurry. I preached the message one time. Sometimes God sends a baby and waits. Sent Moses and waited. What I'm talking about, sent a baby named Moses. He sent a baby named Jesus and waits 33 years for Him to die on the old rugged cross for my salvation. He waited for me 19 years from my birth, hearing a gospel message every week, at least once a week, and many times 3 and 4 and 5 times a week. But He waited for me to do the work of salvation when I allowed it to happen. they would make this. He's still working on to make me what I ought to be. It took him just a day to make the moon and stars. And I can't remember the rest of the song. So. Jesus is calling. The King has chosen you. First, he's chosen you to be a father to you through the new birth. He wants to adopt you into the family of God. That's a decision that you make. We have an adopted son. I have an adopted son. And I can't tell the difference between him and the rest of them.
Amen.
And it's a shame if you do adopt a child and you can't tell the difference. But they can tell the difference if you treat them differently. But I tell you, God, the wonderful thing about the loving arms of God, they're long enough to reach down and pull a new child in every moment of every day. When that child believes on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. And you're adopted into the family of God and stamped in heaven. Your name is written down in indelible ink, and it cannot be removed by the bad things that you have done or the bad things that somebody might say about you. Can I? Let's see, where is that song? Here it is. I tried to talk God out of making a preacher out of me. I was going to be a singer. And let me sing a song for you. I can. Jesus is tenderly calling me home, calling today, calling today. Why from the sunshine of love wilt thou roam? Farther and farther away. But listen to the second verse too. Jesus is calling the weary to rest. Calling today, calling today. Bring him thy burdens and thou shalt be blessed. He will not turn you away. The last verse. Usually we don't get around to this one. Jesus is pleading. Oh, listen to his voice. Hear him today. Hear him today. They who believe on his name shall rejoice. Quickly arise. I used to sing that song with a megaphone. I could curl your hair. But I want to tell you, the message is the same, whether loud or softly.
Amen.
Jesus is calling you. Would you put your faith and trust in Christ as your Savior right where you are? You can be saved right there. You can trust Christ that He can save you. Because he's done it all. He paid it all. Child of God, why don't you today just crown him the king of your life and let him be first. Let him order your daily life, your married life, your life as a husband or wife or a son or a daughter. Just let him take control. Lord, say, whatever you want. While we stand and while we give this invitation, I'll turn the service to Brother Ryan, and we'll give this invitation. I pray that you just don't pass over this thing as some little silly notion that we have about you surrendering to God, because it's the most serious decision that you can make. The decision needs to be made now. Don't wait till you're old and worn out. If you're already old and worn out, you got it another day, you got another week, you got another year. Give it to the King. Let him take control.